Invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Ephesians chapter 2. We got a long way to go tonight and a short time to get there. So you listen fast and I talk fast. But I want to try, if we can, to finish up Ephesians chapter 2, beginning with verse 4 in a moment, going down through verse number 10. That's where we left off last Sunday night in chapter 2, verse number 4. So I want to read these verses again, and then we'll come back and talk about them. Verse 4, "But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Now, those first three verses of Ephesians chapter 2 are really some of the, how would I explain them, some of the ugliest verses, I think, in all the Bible, as it's talking about the destructiveness of sin. But then when we get into verse number 4, it's like a ray of light bursts forth on the scene, and we're talking here in these verses about the greatness of God. And the greatness of God is really revealed in these verses in two ways. Number one, he talks about what God's work for us, and then he begins to talk about God's work in us, and in reality, God's work through us. And that's where we really see the greatness of God. Now, we had begun to kind of pick this verse number 4 apart last Wednesday night, and we began to talk about God's work for us, and we said the first thing contained within that was that he loved us. And we spent a lot of time talking about the love of God, and we said that the love of God, God's love, is one of God's attributes. And remember, we said that God's attributes, according to the scholars, they're divided into two different sections. You have the intrinsic attributes of God, those attributes that he possesses in and of himself. And then we have the what they call the relative attributes of God, and that is the way that God relates those attributes unto us. For example, a part of his intrinsic attributes would be his love, his life, his holiness, and then those by which he relates to man, those relative attributes. For example, the nature of God is truth. So we could say that truth is one of the intrinsic attributes of God, but when he relates it to man, it becomes his faithfulness. God is by nature holy, but when he relates that holiness to man, it becomes justice. Love is one of God's intrinsic attributes, but when this love is related to sinners, it becomes grace and mercy. So the love of God, when we're talking about that, no doubt it is an attribute of God, but it's one of those intrinsic attributes, and when he relates it to us, it is known as his grace and his mercy. So what did God do for us? Well, number one, he loved us. But now, number two, I want to pick up verse number 5, and the Bible says that he quickened us. Even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. That word quickened there just literally means to make alive. And you know, when we think about that, we could honestly say that that is the greatest need that we as sinners have. We need to be made alive. Because as verses 1 through 3 tell us, and then he mentions it again in verse number 5, the problem is that we are dead. We are dead in our trespasses and sins. So in our natural state, our unredeemed state, our fallen state, the state of the old man that Brother Ken just sang about that dwells within us, that part cannot relate to God in any way, because that part of us is dead. So we need to be made alive. Now, I'm a guy that I always ask questions. Whenever I read a passage in the scripture, I always ask the question, how? Or I ask the question, why? How can that be done? And when I read that God has quickened us, that he's made us alive, the first question that I have is, well, Lord, how did you do that? And when we read the Bible, we understand that he accomplishes this spiritual resurrection by the power of the Holy Spirit. But he does that in one specific way, and that is by the Word. So how does God make us alive who were spiritually dead? He does it by the power of the Spirit, and he does it through the Word. Now, I don't know if you're aware of this, but in the four Gospels, it records three times that Jesus raised people from the dead. Three accounts where Jesus raised people from the dead. And that's vitally important to our study here when we're talking about Jesus raising us spiritually from the dead. So what I want us to do, hold our place here in Ephesians, and I want us to go back to Luke's Gospel, chapter number 7, where we were this morning, the 7th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And I want us to read together these accounts, these three accounts, because I'm looking for one specific word here, and hopefully you will catch on to that. Luke chapter 7, verse 11 through 17, and that gives us the account of Jesus raising the widow's son physically from the dead. Luke chapter 7, verse number 11. Now it happened the day after that he went into a city called Nain. Many of his disciples went with him and a large crowd. And when he came near the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother. She was a widow, and a large crowd from the city was with her. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and he said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came and he touched the open coffin, and those who carried him stood still. Mark this, and he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." So he who was dead sat up, and he began to speak, and he presented him unto his mother. Remember, I'm saying that we are raised from the dead by the power of the Holy Spirit through the Word. Now look at Luke chapter 8, verse number 49. Luke chapter 8, verse number 49. While he was still speaking, someone came from the ruler of the synagogue's house, saying to him, "Your daughter is dead. Do not trouble the teacher." But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, "Do not be afraid, only believe, and she will be made well." When he came into the house, he permitted no one to go in except Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the girl. Now all wept and mourned for her, but he said, "Do not weep. She is not dead, but sleeping." And they ridiculed him, knowing that she was dead. But he put them all outside, took her by the hand, and called, saying unto her, "Little girl, arise." Then her spirit returned, and she rose immediately, and he commanded that she be given something to eat. And her parents were astonished, but he charged them to tell no one. When was she risen from the dead physically? When Jesus said to her, "Arise." And then that famous passage over in John's Gospel, chapter number 11. Turn there with me, if you will, please. John chapter 11, and beginning at verse number 41. John 11, verse number 41. The three times Jesus raised someone from the dead. John 11, verse 41. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying. Jesus lifted up his eyes and he said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know that you always hear me, but because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, saying, "Lazarus, come forth." And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Loose him and let him go." Now, in each individual case, what did Jesus do? Jesus spoke the word, and this is what gave life. In Hebrews chapter 4, in verse number 12, what does the Bible say about the Bible? It says that the Word of God is living, that it's active, that it's powerful, that it's sharper than any two-edged sword. That is why you can read the Bible, a text today, and it can say one thing to you. You can read it tomorrow, and it can say an entirely different thing to you, because the Bible is living, it's breathing, it's fresh. It's kind of like I've told you that one of the best ways to learn the Bible is to take one of the short books like the book of Ephesians, read it through at one setting, and do that for 30 days. Now, if you do that after 30 days, I guarantee you're going to know what's contained in the book of Ephesians. But what is interesting is that you can read it through one day, it'll say one thing to you. Read it through the next day, say another thing. Read it through the next day, it'll say another thing. It's the Word of God that has life. And I believe that the three physical resurrections that we read about are pictures of spiritual resurrections that come to the sinner when the sinner hears the Word and when the sinner believes the Word. John chapter 5, verse number 24, Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he who hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life." What is it that passes a person from death unto life? It is hearing and responding to the word of God. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 3, the Bible says, "Hear and your soul shall live." Hear what? Hear the word of God. You see, spiritual life does not come by joining a church, does not come by being baptized, does not come by participating in the Lord's Supper. Spiritual life comes by hearing and receiving the word of God, which is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. I think a great illustration of this is the book of Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. Turn over there, you're in Ephesians. Turn to Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. Great illustration here of what the Word does when we hear it and receive it. Here the Bible's talking about the living Word, which of course is the Lord Jesus. So we have the living Word, and then we have the written Word, which is the Bible. But in Colossians 1, verse 16, "For by him," that's Jesus, "all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him," Jesus, "all things consist." That means all things are held together. So all things are created by Jesus. All things are held together by Jesus. Who is Jesus? He is the living Word. How did Jesus create all things? How did he do it? Did he wave his hand? "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God, and that Word spoke creation into being, and it had life." How did God create Adam and Eve? By His Word. How does God create us as spiritual beings? By His Word. And then after He creates us by His Word, what is it that holds us together? It's that same Word that gave us spiritual life in the first place. So if we get saved and then we neglect the Word, guess what's going to happen to us? We're going to begin to die. We're going to begin to rot on the vine. So after we're saved, God doesn't just mystically zap us and all of a sudden, you know, we grow and we mature. It doesn't happen that way. The only way we grow and mature and keep life together is by staying in the Word of God, the very thing that created us in the Spirit and gave us life in the first place. Does that make sense? So that tells us what a supreme role then that the Word of God has to play in our lives. So the Bible says that He loved us. The Bible says that He quickened us. Then down in verse number 6, the Bible says that He exalted us, exalted us. Verse 6, I'm in Colossians. Let me get back to Ephesians. Colossians won't work there. Verse number 6, "And He raised us up together, and He made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." So when we got saved, when we got born again, we were spiritually resurrected. And at that moment, what did he do? He raised us up and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The good news is that when we were saved, when the Lord saved us, we were dead, right, in our trespasses and sin. We were in a spiritual graveyard. But the good news is he didn't leave us in the graveyard, but he resurrected us. Just like Lazarus, when he was resurrected, he didn't stay in the graveyard. And so our physical position, and this is hard to understand, but our physical position may be on the earth, but our spiritual position is in the heavenlies. So the moment we get born again, and man, this is going to tie right together with the next point, so hold on to it. Our spiritual position, that's God's perspective, the way God sees us. We are already seated in the heavenlies with Christ. That means that we have access to everything that Christ has access to. That means that we don't have to wait till we get to heaven to enjoy all of the spiritual benefits and blessings of being born again. We can get in on it right now because God sees us as having already been there. We are there. Now, what an amazing verse this is when you begin to break it down, because the Greek verb behind the word seated is in what we refer to as the aorist tense, and it emphasizes the absoluteness of a promise that is given that cannot be broken, a promise that is given that you can take to the bank because it's speaking of something that has already fully taken place. So we are, in God's mind and God's view, already seated where Jesus is. Now, when I think about that, the picture that comes to my mind is that God has so enveloped us in Christ that when he looks at us, he always sees him. He doesn't see Craig, doesn't see Ken, doesn't see John, but when he looks at us in Christ, we're so enveloped in Christ that what God sees is Christ. A great illustration of that is kind of like the boards of the Old Testament tabernacle. And we read back in the book of Exodus that those boards were made from this rough, twisted, what the Bible refers to as acacia wood. And that acacia wood of the tabernacle was encased in gold. So when people looked at those boards of acacia wood, they were so encased in gold, they didn't see the old knotted up, twisted boards of the acacia wood. The only thing they saw was the gold. And we are so encased in Christ that when God looks at us, all that God sees is Christ. He sees the Lord Jesus. And another good illustration of that is back in the book of Exodus, if you want to look there, in Exodus chapter number 12. You know that story well, the story of the Passover, but it's a perfect illustration of what he's saying here, that we're seated in the heavenlies with Christ, and that when God looks at us, what he sees is Christ. Exodus chapter 12, verse 1. Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all of the congregation of Israel, saying, that every man shall take for himself a lamb according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons, according to each man's needs. You shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight, and they shall take some of the blood, put it on the two doorposts of the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Verse number 12 and 13, for I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all of the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both man and beast, against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment because I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, And when I see the blood, I will pass over you in judgment. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Why? Because when I look where you are dwelling, all I see is that blood, that sacrificial payment for your sins. And so many of God's people, they live their lives in fear of having to face one day a judgment that's going to cast them into eternal hell, while God says, I see you already glorified in the heavenlies. That is an impossibility. That cannot take place if you're a child of God. So because he exalts us, then it leads us to the next step of the story, and that is he keeps us. If we are exalted, we've got to be kept. And that's what he points out in verses 7 through 10. So that in the ages to come. Now just underscore the word ages, circle it, because you know what that word means? In eternity to come. For in eternity to come, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. That it's not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for the purpose of doing good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now listen carefully. God's purpose for our redemption is not simply to rescue us from hell. That's what we think sometimes. Now that's a great work, can I get a witness? That God would send Jesus to rescue us from hell. That is a great work, but that is not God's primary purpose in rescuing us. His ultimate purpose in our salvation is that for all eternity, the church might glorify God by putting on display the wonder of God's grace. We saw this in our introduction back in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verse number 6. We are saved to the purpose of the glory of his grace by which he made us accepted in the beloved. Down in verse number 12 of chapter 1, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. Verse number 14, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. Now, folks, listen. If that's God's eternal purpose, and that has been God's plan from the very beginning, that those who are the redeemed will be in glory forever and ever and ever for the purpose of giving glory to God, how could he not keep us for all eternity? If that is his purpose. You see, since we have not been saved by our good works, we can't be lost by our bad works. Now, bad works are not a good thing. We should never say, well, you know, since we're not saved by our works, then it's no big deal if I'm involved in bad works. Well, yes, it is. We're to live our lives to glorify God right now, aren't we? I'm not saying that. I'm just trying to make this point that since we are not saved by our good works, we cannot be unsaved by our bad works. The whole idea of grace, God's riches at Christ's expense, means that salvation is completely apart from any merit or works on our part. Because if there was anything on our part that had to do with merit or works, then it would cease to be grace. And it would become works. Grace means that God does it all and he does it for Jesus' sake. Because our salvation is the gift of God. If I offered you a gift tonight, Scott, what is the only thing you would have to do to get it? Accept it. Receive it. I wouldn't say, I'm going to give you this ink pen. I'm not going to do that because my granddaughter Michaela gave it to me. But if I were to say, I'm going to give you this ink pen, I tell you what, if you'll give me $25, you can have it. That wouldn't be a gift at all, would it? No. You would be paying me something for it. Now, I want to make a point in verse number 8. I don't want to belabor it, but I think it's interesting here because those who are of the hyper-Calvinist persuasion, You know, hyper-Calvinism basically means that God chooses you to either go to heaven or to go to hell. And hyper-Calvinists use verse number 8 in a way that I believe that scripturally, hermeneutically, they can't use this verse to point out that salvation is of such of God that we have nothing to do really even believing, that even the faith that we have is something that God has to give us or we cannot be saved. Now, we know to a degree that is true, right? But the hyper-Calvinists take that, to the extent, and they say, you know, salvation is so of God. The free will of man has absolutely nothing to do with it. And they use this word, and they use the word that in verse number 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. And they use the word that to refer to faith. So that faith is what they're talking about. That faith is the gift of God. Now, I know this would just bless your socks off, but I don't think that is possible for that verse to mean that, because in the Greek New Testament, that word that is neuter in gender, while the word faith is feminine, which means that it could not be referring to the word faith. Because when you look at it in the context of that word, what it means is that it's referring to the entire experience of salvation, not to the one word, that. So contrary to what the hyper-Calvinists say, that is not possible. When you really look at that word and break that word down and look at the Greek meaning of the word. The whole point of the verse that he's trying to make is that salvation is a gift of God, and it's not some kind of a reward for meritorious service. That's what he's talking about in that verse. He's not trying to break the word faith out of the entire context of the experience of salvation. So when we talk about our salvation, salvation cannot be of works. Why? Because the work of salvation has already been completed. The work of salvation was completed by Jesus on the cross. So what else can we do to add to salvation? Look back in John chapter 17. I want to walk you through a few verses here. John chapter 17, verses 1 through 4. John 17. Look in your Bibles there and let's read these verses together. John 17, verse number 1, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come, glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. Now, in the life of Christ, where would this fall in the chronological table of his life? Somebody tell me. That's his high priestly prayer. And when did it happen? Right before his death, the last week in the earthly life of Jesus. He says to his Father, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have glorified you on this earth. I have what? Finished. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. What was the work that the Father gave Jesus to do? Somebody volunteer. What was the work? To glorify God by doing what? Going to the cross and dying for our sins. And Jesus said, I finished that work. And then if you just flip over a couple of pages to John chapter 19 and verse number 30, so when Jesus had received sour wine, he said, Tetelestai, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. So Jesus accomplished the plan of salvation when he died on the cross. It's finished. What more can be added? And the answer is absolutely nothing.
There's nothing we can add to the finished work of Christ. No amount of good work. No offering of any kind of sacrifices. That's what the book of Hebrews is all about. Over in Hebrews chapter number 10, do I have time to read these verses? Hebrews chapter number 10. Listen to these verses. He's contrasting here now the law versus grace, and the law not being able, obeying it, to lead us to salvation. He says, for the law, verse number 1 of Hebrews 10, if you want to follow along, for the law having a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very image of the things that can never with these same sacrifices, which they offer continually year by year, make those who approach perfect. So the offering of the sacrifices cannot make someone perfect, that is, right in the sight of God. For then they would not have to cease to be offered if that were true. For the worshipers, once purified, would have had no more consciousness of their sins, but they were aware over and over again, even after they made the sacrifices, that they were still sinners. For it's not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins. Therefore, when he came into the world, he said, that's Jesus, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sins, you had no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I've come, Jesus says, in the volume of the book, it's written of me, to do your will, O God. What was God's will? For him to go to the cross, die for sins to provide salvation. Previously saying, sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offerings for sin, you did not desire, nor did you have pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. Then he said, behold, I've come to do your will, O God. He takes away the first, that he may establish the second. By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. There's nothing else we can do. Do you remember when Jesus died on the cross? What supernatural event took place in the temple? The veil was torn from the top to the bottom, signifying that now there was open access into the presence of a holy God. There is no more need for sacrifices, because one sacrifice has been made, the sacrifice of the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world. He finished God's great work of redemption when he died on the cross. There's nothing else that can be added to that. Friend, God did it, and what Paul is trying to get us to see is he did it by grace, not by our works, not by our merit. You see, sin worked against us, but I go back to my initial point. God worked for us. He worked for us in providing that gracious provision of the Lord Jesus. I don't know if you've ever thought about it this way, but I think that man's sin really gave God an opportunity to display a side of his character that we may not have seen in any other way. What do we see about the character of God when we look at the work of creation? We see his power. We see his wisdom. But friend, when we look at his redemption, what do we see? We see his grace, and we see his mercy. And the only way we could have seen that side of the character of God was through what happened to Jesus when he died on the cross. And friend, when you boil it down, wrap it up in a nutshell, that's really the difference between Christianity and every false religion. Every false religion has as its core belief man can do something to earn his salvation. Man can merit it in some way. That's the core of every single false religion. And yet the Bible comes along and the gospel absolutely obliterates that. Because what the gospel says is that God has provided not just a way, but the only way of salvation. And that was not by the works of man, but that was by the gift of God that was based on nothing but the amazing grace of God. So the gospel obliterates all of that. You know, salvation can only be received through our believing, right? By faith in what the gospel proclaims.
And yet that's the only way that salvation can be received is by believing. And yet it seems to me that the Bible indicates that for all eternity, that Jesus is going to be stationed there with nail prints in his feet and hands to show what the cost of our salvation was. How do we know that? How do we know that when we get to heaven, how do we know that we're going to be able to see the nail prints in the hands and the feet and the spear wound in his side? How do we know we're going to see that? Remember in John 20, when Jesus in his resurrected glorified body, the one he's going to have in heaven, remember when he appeared to Thomas? What did Thomas say before he got there? Unless I see the nail prints in his feet and his hands, unless I thrust my hand into the wound in his side, I will not believe. And remember, Jesus walked through the door and showed up. And when Thomas saw him, what did he see? Because Jesus said, Thomas, go ahead, stick your hands in these holes in my hands and feet. Stick your hand in that wound in my side. And when Thomas saw those wounds, what did he say? My Lord and my God. He didn't need to touch him. So I think that through all eternity, that there's a verse back in, if I can find it, Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 13. You know where Zechariah is in the Old Testament? If you find Malachi, which is the last book, and go back to the left, you'll find it. But in Malachi chapter, or Zechariah chapter 13, verse number 6, listen at this verse. And one will say to him, what are these wounds between your arms? Then he will answer, those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends. That is a prophecy of the second coming of Jesus. And he said, people are going to ask me about those wounds. Friend, when I think about those wounds, and I take those wounds and I wrap it around what I've just learned in the book of Ephesians, I can tell you one thing for sure. Ain't going to be nobody strutting around heaven saying, look what I did. Nobody there is going to be bragging, walking around like a peacock. That's not going to happen. We're going to look at those wounds in those hands and those feet and that side, and we're going to say, this is all by the grace of God. And for all eternity, what's going to happen? What's going to happen is we're going to praise him for his glorious, glorious grace. Well, that's a good place to stop. Tonight I want to give an invitation, since we've been talking about God's gracious salvation. Brother Ken is going to come. I'm going to ask you if you will just stand for a moment and bow your heads and close your eyes, and maybe God's Spirit has spoken to someone here tonight and you would like to give your heart to this amazing Jesus. Man, there's no one like him, no Savior like him, no one who has ever loved you like him. And I know that probably the majority here tonight are believers, but maybe someone is here tonight who is not. And tonight you would like to come and give your life and your heart to this amazing Savior. Maybe you'd like to join our church family or come to the altar to pray. I'm going to lead us in prayer, and then Brother Ken's going to sing, and I'm going to ask you to respond if God's touched your life. Father, thank you for your amazing grace. No wonder that the songwriter called it amazing. I don't have any better word to describe it. God, thank you that at one moment in time that you came down and you rescued us from a corrupt, sinful, depraved life. And God, when we think about the cost, it's almost more than we can bear. We just say to you tonight, Lord Jesus, we love you for doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. And Father, I pray that tonight, if there are those here who would like to come to you, I pray that they would come in Jesus' name.
I'm so glad that you've chosen to tune in to our broadcast. And it's the prayer of my heart as you have walked into our worship center by way of television that you have been encouraged as you have listened to the great music that's been provided by our sanctuary choir and orchestra, and as you have listened to the instruction that has come from God's Word, that you really have been strengthened with something that will help you in your walk with God. And if you have yet to discover the wonderful gift of salvation that is provided to us through Jesus Christ our Lord, I pray that you might call upon His name.